Good evening and good morning from Asia Society Hong Kong Center here in Hong Kong. I am delighted that all of you can join us tonight for our episode 22 of our Asia Society Hong Kong COVID-19 update, where we have the opportunity to speak directly to the experts, with the experts regarding the ever-changing development of COVID-19. From the pandemic itself to the research about the vaccine, about the disease, and about how it's affecting all of us as we live through this really once in a lifetime, once in a century public health event or emergency, depending on how you look at it. Today, September 3rd, 2020, we have about 26 million cases, over 26 million cases globally, and over 18 million recovered. And also over 860,000 deaths globally. US is still number one, over 6 million cases, and followed by Brazil and India. And here in Hong Kong, we have been very, very fortunate. Our latest count is 4,839. And for the last 3 or 4 days, our case number has been in single digits. And so far, we have had 93 deaths. More social distancing measures in Hong Kong will be lifted tomorrow, allowing restaurants to open till 10 p.m. And we will be reopening gyms and cinemas. And we're really excited about that. Hong Kong started its community testing scheme also this week on September 1st. And over 10% of the population have signed up. The number that I read this morning was six out of the initial 128,000 cases. Six out of the 128 initial testing were tested positive. So that's pretty good numbers. And so those are the kind of the numbers, the statistics that we wanted to share with you before we start speaking with our experts tonight. We're delighted, Dr. Gigi Guanville, from senior scholar, associate professor at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security and associate professor in the Department of Environmental Health and Engineering at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. She's an immunologist by training, and we're really delighted that we have the opportunity tonight to talk to her about serology, about the various testing. And also we wanna take this opportunity to also ask her opinion and just update us on what's happening around the world of vaccine. So good morning, Dr. Guanville. Thank you for joining us this evening in your morning.
Thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to be here. I wish that I could be here with you in person, but this is the way it's going to be for a while. I am going to share my screen. Can you see it?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so if you can walk us through about some of the work you're doing in serology and the testing, I think that has been a lot of mystery around that. So I'm going to turn it over to you. Yes.
Thank you. Yeah. So I'm going to talk about, there are lots of different kinds of tests, and I think it's pretty, it can be a little overwhelming and confusing, even if you're not following it daily like we are. So I just want to give a little bit of an overview of what the different kinds of tests are and what they should and should not be used for, what we're hoping to see in the months ahead as new types of tests are developed, the whole idea of what a sero survey is and how the good way to do that and some poor ways to try to do sero surveys. And then I'm happy to answer any kind of questions about the U.S. approach to any of the below vaccines, clinical trials, and whatever about COVID that has something to do with the science, because that's all that I do. So I'll start with the different kinds of testing types. Basically, tests for COVID go into two categories. There's diagnostic tests that are aimed to track whether somebody is currently infected. And those are PCR tests, which are very sensitive, that look for the genetic material of the virus, or rapid antigen tests. And those are pretty fast, less sensitive, but that look for the complete virion. So it looks like it looks for the outside of the virus. So if you have that, then you're infected. So that's diagnostic. Then if you clear the virus from your body, you still have the immunology of your, you have your immune, your defenses against the virus, your antibodies and T cells. And we only can look for antibodies. So it's one measure of seeing that you were previously infected. And those are serology or antibody tests. You can use either of those terms interchangeably. And we track all the different kinds of tests. There are hundreds at different manufacturers, and they have different levels of accuracy on our website. So if you are looking for one-stop shop for any of these testing things, you can find it on our site. So like I said, molecular testing, PCR testing is an example of this, looks for the virus genetic material. You're not gonna have this if you're not currently infected, but it is very sensitive. And so sometimes people take a while to clear out all of the genetic material from their body. And that's why sometimes people will test positive long after they're no longer currently infectious. So that's molecular testing. There are many different tests that are available on the market, the US market, 138 tests that have gotten emergency use authorization. That is the way that our regulatory, the FDA allows them to be marketed and used. It's not a full FDA approval, but it's a different category. And we have the nucleic acid tests, that mostly PCR, and then antigen tests, which are fast. I'll explain what those are in just a second. Okay, so antigen tests, they're not as sensitive as PCR. So PCR is pretty amazing in what it can do. It looks for genetic material and it amplifies it, like making lots and lots of copies in a Xerox machine, or you know, so you can see something that's very, very tiny, and then you can amplify it, and so you can see much clearer. Antigen tests don't do that. They look for what's there. They look for, this is what's called a lateral flow assay, and just means that it the liquid that you put on one side flows from one direction to another. And there are different antibodies that are embedded in the test itself that bind to the virus. So if the virus is there, it'll bind, and then you have some sort of colorimetric way to highlight that. And you'll see if you have virus in whatever sample it is, whether it's a nasal swab or saliva sample or a nasopharyngeal, what has been termed in the news here is a brain swab, because it has to go really deep into your nose. I'm sure a lot of you have had this. So this is like a pregnancy test. This is that kind of test. And there are different kinds of those. So why, this is all diagnostic. This is trying to figure out if you're infectious. The limit of these kinds of tests is often a trade-off between time and accuracy. PCR and other nucleic acid tests are very sensitive and they're very specific. That means that they can find, even if you have very low levels of virus, and they can rule out that it's not something else. But it's time intensive and it requires special equipment. Antigen tests, like the kind that are more like the pregnancy test, they are not amplification tests, so you have to be pretty have a lot of virus to be able to be detected. So they're not able to catch you early on in your infection, but they can catch you, show you as positive when you've got a lot of virus in the sample. So they're a trade-off between accuracy and time. And this is just showing the different kinds of what I want you to focus on is the time to results. In the US, we're having huge problems right now because it's taking days and days for people to get their results back. But that's not the fault of the test. That's the fault of other processes and maybe staffing issues as well, because PCR takes 2 to 4 hours to complete. But the other tests are much faster. And the rapid antigen test, the lateral flow test, the one that's like a pregnancy test, it can take 15 minutes. And so that's become more favored Like I said, we have this all on our website, and including their accuracy levels. And so if you know anybody who is concerned that their test might not have been accurate, you could see what the percentage probability of false positive or false negative might be. So this is the trade-off between accuracy and sensitivity raises, it's been a very big conversation right now, largely led by a Harvard epidemiologist named Michael Mina. What kind of test do we really need when we're trying to beat this infection? We need something that's rapid. We need something that has no special equipment. A lot of even the rapid antigen tests require a special reader so you need to have, like, if in order to use those tests, you have to have this investment up front of that reader. You need something that's inexpensive and so that you could take it again and again. Perhaps if you're going onto a flight, or perhaps if you're going into a business, you need something that is a lot more available and cheap. And so that may be the rapid antigen test, but there's this ongoing debate over whether that is sensitive enough and how cheap is cheap. And there is a recent test that has just gotten emergency use authorization that was put out by Abbott Laboratories. That is a $5 15-minute test that doesn't require a reader. And so that is, that's a huge advance and a great development, but $5 is still a little pricey for the kind of larger scale, especially for school systems that we need. So that is going to be an ongoing debate, and hopefully in a few months, we'll have the federal investment into cheap pieces of paper that people can use with saliva, and maybe even have two different tests on the piece of paper so that increases your accuracy. So that is the dream test that I hope we will have. So now that's current infection. I want to talk about past infection. So antibody testing or serology testing became hugely important in the US because of the very slow start to diagnostic testing. So people were very sick in January, February, and like, did I have COVID? You know, maybe I had COVID, maybe I'm going to be, I don't need to worry about getting it again. The FDA had an incredibly light touch on the regulation and allowed for a lot of manufacturers to enter the market and with very uneven results. So antibody testing, serology testing, look for the presence of antibodies in your serum. So you take your blood, you separate out the blood cells, and what's left is your serum, and you have antibodies in there. And you produce them in response to lots of things, but SARS-CoV-2, about 5 days after you're infected, you start producing one type of antibody called IgM. And then a little bit later, you produce a more durable IgG. Ig stands for immunoglobulin. So anyway, you don't need to know that, but the presence of antibodies mean that you had been infected, even if you had cleared it. And so you could see if you used to have, if there was a point where you were infected. And as 40% of infections are asymptomatic, a lot of people would not know that they had been infected unless they took this serology test. So that's what I just said. So you can use this to capture all individuals who had been infected, but the main reason that it becomes very important for public health is to do seroprevalence studies where you take a group of people, you test to make sure to see if they had been infected before, and you can, from a well-designed seroprevalence survey or a serosurvey, learn what the case fatality rate is, whether any public health intervention that you're putting into place, whether it's working for all groups, or whether there's a particular group that you're not getting or you need to be particularly concerned about. So there's a lot of big public health questions that can only be addressed by doing careful antibody surveys. And I believe it was in Hong Kong that that serosurveys were used to fill in gaps from contact tracing early on. So it can be used that way as well. Problem in the US is that there's a lot of bad tests out there. So a lot of people were getting tested and then they learned it was very likely that if they got positive, that it was a false positive. And so then they were acting, maybe taking different public health risks that they wouldn't have taken if they had a negative test. Statistics don't favor what the results are for individuals, and I'll get into that in a second. But even for a really good test, there is the possibility for a false positive or false negative. And if you're testing a whole population, you'll say like, oh well, a million people and 5% are false positive. You bake that in to your analysis, but we go through life as an N of one. And so if you get a test and it's wrong, that can affect you, in your decision-making. So that's a big problem. There also is, we don't know what antibodies really mean for SARS-CoV-2. What it definitely means is that you were infected, but we don't know if there's a particular level that you need to have in order to remain protected, or whether it's important to prevent becoming infected again. We don't know the answers to those questions yet. And the most important thing for a person is if they were to donate convalescent serum, then that is something that you have to be positive to be able to do that. There's a lot of debate right now over whether convalescent serum is useful, and I can talk about that later, but it certainly is a treatment that is very heavily used in the US. And that's basically, if you're unfamiliar, that's when you'd like take, if somebody's recovered from COVID, you take their serum and you transfuse it into somebody else. So you're basically giving somebody a bit of your immune response. So that's, it's hoped that you can help jumpstart somebody's recovery by giving them somebody else's immune cells. So what makes a good test for serology? They has to be highly sensitive and specific. It's just two ways to measure accuracy. It should be validated, which a lot of them have not been. And so there's a lot of concern that, you know, manufacturers are saying that they're accurate, but they are not. And so the FDA is now cracking down on manufacturers that have reported way too high accuracy levels. And this is what I was saying about how different, even a highly accurate test can lead to false positives and false negatives. And sometimes it just helps to look at the math. If you have a population of a million people and 15% of them are infected, and you have a high, what looks like a highly accurate test, 95% sensitive, 95% specific, you're still going to end up with a lot of false positives, 42,500. And that's, I mean, it adds up when you talk about a million people. And if you, false negatives are not as important for public health. Those people had COVID, 7,500 would think that they had COVID and they didn't. But false positives, people might take different risks. They might not wear their mask as much. They might go into crowd situations. So it could be a real problem. And we track all of those tests as well, the ones that, and what is known about their accuracy. And we update that as well twice weekly. So there is a lot of, all the antibody tests are used for these larger surveys. They may not be as useful for an individual, but I said that they're compiled into surveys and they can give you a lot of good information, including the case fatality rate, whether your public health interventions are working. a lot of times we don't hear about these sero surveys until they're published. And so one of our recommendations in our recent report is that we need to have a place where people announce that they're doing these kinds of surveys and put the results in, including their methodology, similar to the way we do this for clinical trials. You have to have a lot of different information that is put in a public way so that you can see whether the trial is done correctly. And sero surveys, it's the same, because a lot of times people will, there was one sero survey that was reported in the media that was done in Santa Clara, California, and they recruited everybody to participate in the survey using a social media site, Facebook. And you know, not everybody's on Facebook. And so you're not getting a truly random, unbiased group of people to see if they have COVID or have had COVID rather. There was a sero survey that was published about New York City, and they looked for antibodies in grocery store employees. And so that is another very biased sample, because grocery store employees have a lot more contact with people and are in a much more public position than people, what would be a random unbiased group. A lot of times sero surveys don't include all populations. They tend to not include minority groups. So there was a sero survey that was done for the people who are involved in Major League Baseball. And so their survey results skewed a lot older, a lot more male, and a lot more affluent. And so you don't get a good representation of the population if you don't make sure that you're including people of all income levels, of all different walks of life, and make sure it's a diverse sample. And we need to have these kinds of surveys done over time, because this is a new disease that we're just learning about. And so we need to know what the effects are 5 years from now. So we need to make sure that we're designing good surveys so that we can continue to treat people and make sure that we're on top of things 5 years later, because there's going to be some medical sequelae. We're already seeing that, you know, people are not who have had COVID, who might not be back to 100% within the time that most people are. And so we need to look for different interventions that to help people. So just a word about, I know I'm getting close to the end, a word about some vaccines. There are a bunch that are in clinical trials right now and a few that are in phase three. There are going to be some huge challenges with two of the three that are closest to licensure. Is a new technology for vaccines. They're genetic vaccines. If it works, it will be a major transformation of the vaccine world, because it will be much easier to produce those kinds of vaccines than others. But they have very big logistical problems, including a need for cold chain, and in the case of the Pfizer product, an ultra cold chain. So that has those vaccines have to be kept at minus 70 degrees. So that's a big problem for getting the world vaccinated. And just because there's never a bad time to remind people to protect themselves against the flu, because even though it seems like you're not interacting with anybody enough to catch any disease, never mind the flu, you don't want to get the flu, and you don't want to think that you might have COVID. And then finally, this just came out today. This is a scanning electron microscope image of SARS-CoV-2. It's just and the infection of airway cells, bronchial epithelial cells. And it's in the New England Journal of Medicine, if you can't see the crisp detail that you would see if you were looking at my screen, or looking at the paper. But it's just fascinating how it and beautiful in a way, but also scary. So I'm happy to talk about any of these things, including testing. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Grumbel. And that last shot of that, I think for those in the audience, you're seeing it for the first time. In fact, as Dr. Guano has just informed us, it's brand new. So this webcast will be on Asia Society website, and we encourage you, those of you who are interested, to look at it in more detail to come back and look at it. And all these information will also be on our dedicated website for COVID-19, so people can go back and reference it. But I'm really interested, Dr. Grumbel, to talk a little bit about the survey that you did in June. That I think in June, I think in the U.S. was kind of the beginning. I think people were, you know, here in Hong Kong, I think for us, it was February when we kind of started at the beginning of COVID. And in the U.S., I think they were kind of behind. So in June, I think is when, I think maybe May, and then you did this study, the developing national strategy for sero surveys in the United States. And you had some really interesting recommendations. And I'm just curious, from June until now, has some of these recommendations, can you talk about the recommendations and whether have they been followed? And because we're looking at it, the situation from here in Hong Kong, and looking at not just the U.S., but Europe, the situation seems, and part of it, a bigger place. But kind of from that study, what have they done right in the U.S., and what have they done not so right? And talk about that.
Sure. So we actually had two reports that had something to do with antibodies. And the first was we were kind of growing in alarm about how people were thinking that using these serology tests as a for immunity passports, that was the, I don't know if that was a thing. And we were kind of like, okay, we need to put some information out there about that, because the idea was that if you had COVID and you could test positive with a serology test, then, you don't need to do any physical distancing. It's like a get-out-of-jail-free card. And so we had to push back on that, because there's so much that we don't know about the virus yet. Like, we don't know if having had it means that you can't get it again, how long immunity is going to last. And because of all the tests that have so many false positives, what if you, like I said, what if you think you're test positive, but you didn't actually have the disease? And so we put that report out, and then we started seeing more of these sero surveys, like the one I mentioned in California and New York, and there were highly publicized ones in Italy and the UK. Everyone's trying to look to see if maybe we could, we've already reached herd immunity, and then we can stop protection. And so we thought we need to put out a guide for how you actually do a sero survey. And this is the recommendations. I'll talk about the recommendations in a second, but it was also just to try and educate our media on like what they should be looking for. So if New York announces that they're having a test, I'd like more people to say, well, according to this study, you should make sure that you have a random unbiased sample, that you gathered people from all income levels, that you took samples from them so you could do analysis later, and all the kinds of things that make a good sero survey, because these things are not cost free. I mean, they're expensive to do. They take a lot of time and resources. So you might as well do it right. And that was the point that we had. And so to help doing that right, we recommended that you have a central repository so that everybody could learn what sero surveys were being done, were being planned, and then what the results were. One of the things the U.S. did really wrong is had this really a lack of a federal response when it comes to sero surveys, and also when it comes to almost everything else. And so where I am in the state of Maryland, they're doing serosurveys. New York is doing serosurveys. California is doing serosurveys. So everybody is going it alone. And if everybody develops their own methodology, then it's the results are not going to be as comparable. And it's just a lot of wasted effort. The CDC has initiated some surveys for different kinds of surveys and that are more than one state, but even they don't publish their methodology so that the states can copy it. Are recommendations being taken up? We're talking to different lawmakers about possibly putting that into legislation because it would need to be funded and specifically asked for. It's not going to be useful for now, but hopefully in the next year or so, if that were to be developed, that would be a great thing. Canada has a site called Serotracker. And it's not what we asked for, but at least they have a central repository of all information about serosurveys in the world.
I see. One of the questions I want to ask you is about our own testing here in Hong Kong, as I mentioned, starting Tuesday, September 1st, and ours was the nasal swab and the saliva, not the deep. And within a day and a half, I know because I took the test on the first, and this afternoon got the results back negative. Very happy about that. But that test is the nucleic acid test, correct? Or is it? And so right now, I know we have some controversy here. The government would like to see as many people get tested. So why? I guess I know the question, but why would a test like that? I guess the more people that take that test, the more the government can get a bigger picture. I guess my understanding is the more better picture they have with more people participating, then they can decide on whether to open the restaurants or, you know, the social distancing measures. So can you talk about pros and cons from your perspective of this particular test that I've talked about for Hong Kong?
Yeah, so the PCR test is most accurate. It takes a little bit longer. I am not as, there's some people who are very passionate about one kind of test or another. I generally think that all testing is good as long as it's accurate. but the problem is for PCR testing is that it does take a little bit longer to get your result. And I think here we're relying much more on individuals to make decisions, sadly, than having government control. So we need to give people that information sooner. And the advantage of having the other kind of test, the rapid antigen test, is that, so PCR, it's great, you know, with PCR, if you're negative, it's a much clearer picture that you are truly negative. With the rapid antigen test, you could still be on your way to getting very sick and you would basically, miss a day or two of that infection. But the advantage of the rapid antigen test is that you're not going to test positive unless you have a lot of virus in your nose. And so it's almost like a contagion test. So you're not going to be breathing out, you know, tons of virions into the air unless you've got a lot of them in there. And so if you test positive for the rapid antigen test, and you know the result in 15 minutes and it's positive, you need to be isolated immediately. Like, you are contagious. And so that is the advantage of those. Of course, I say that and I just want to make clear that, like, all tests have false positives and false negatives. And so, you know, you have to plan for what you do next. I didn't say this, but like, for some, there's no, depending on what you do next when you test positive, it could have big consequences for the individual, for sure. Like, maybe you wouldn't be able to get on a plane, or maybe you wouldn't be able to go to work, or whatever maybe you wouldn't be able to have your surgery, your elective surgery. But for other diseases, if it's super, super important to know if you're truly positive, like, for example, HIV, you don't just rely on one test.
Right.
They will give you a test, and if you turn out to be HIV positive, they follow it up with a second and a third test. And that's what you do in these situations if it's so important to know for sure. And so that may be where we end up going with COVID in the future when testing becomes more plentiful, that you can follow it up with a better test.
Well, I guess the question, recently I have some friends who came back from the US, which is, I think the Hong Kong government just changed the rules on testing or arrival from the US. And mm-hmm. have to have a negative, being negative to get on a plane. And so my understanding with the friends in the US is they've been in the US for the all summer and trying to get the test within, I guess, the 3-day period.
Right.
And it was just a nightmare. And I heard about it. And in some ways, I'm worried because need to go back to the States and hopefully around Christmas. And trying to find that here in Hong Kong, I think what was really interesting was what we're going through is the government, you know, you book it online, within 3 days, they guarantee the results. And sure enough, a day and a half later, they text me with the negative results. So here in Hong Kong, we're smaller, we're 5 million, you know, the target is to do 5 million. So far, almost 1 million has signed up. So Hong Kong being small has its, you know, and also being very well organized. I mean, the government,
yes, yes, absolutely,
so well organized. But in the States, I guess, like you kind of alluded to, each of the states, they're not coordinating. You know, and because my sister lives in New York and family in Virginia, I know. But they're traveling, right? And mm-hmm. and so right now, some of the concerns are the schools are reopening, and right. I understand universities are also doing their own testing. But again, the lack of coordination. Just because you have one negative doesn't mean, like you said, so there has to be this frequent testing, correct? To keep things going. So it sounds like it's expensive. And but let's right now, I want to encourage our audience, online audience. They have the Slido Co. We already have some great questions here, and this is your opportunity to really ask the expert. Because I think before your wonderful presentation, I knew about these various tests, but I think in that one presentation, got it. Two type of tests, molecular and the other one. But I think for me, having just taken the test on Monday, I now understand why and a bit better. But I think this question is coming from Michael in the audience. He asks, the antigen test has accuracy sensitivity rate of 80 to 85%. Has that changed since May? And if antigen test shows a false negative, people with that could still spread the virus?
Yeah, when you are infected, the amount of virus that is in your body, in your nose, in your mouth, that you're breathing out, it's a bell-shaped curve. So the nice thing about PCR is it can detect in that before it goes to the hump. Yes, the rapid antigen test is not going to catch that. It is more likely, it's more accurate when you're at that the top of the curve and you have a lot of virus. So yes, it's not as accurate, and 80 something percent is about what you get. A lot of people have personal familiarity with strep tests. So the strep test is another rapid antigen test. I'm sure a lot of people have experience where they're sick as a dog and they go to the clinic and they get tested and it's negative and you're like, what? I know that I have this. So yes, there are times when you're gonna miss cases. But from a public health perspective, the models show that even the tests that are less accurate like that, you're going to be able to stop enough chains of transmission to make it worth it.
And you previously talked about the convalescent antibodies. And I know the president had mentioned, President Trump had mentioned it. Yes. Can you talk about that? This is one of the questions from the online audience. The convalescent antibody, is that, I mean, and that's a lot of people. I remember when in the beginning, there was a lot of hope here in this part of the world with what happened with, in Wuhan, people were using, you know, hoping that would be something that can help us solve this problem. So can you talk about that issue, the convalescent
sera? So convalescent sera is a, it's an old technology. Before it was used, before 1918, it was used before we even knew what caused the flu. You know, viruses weren't identified until 15 years after 1918. So it was common, and most, at least in the U.S., most state public health labs made serum, and they gave people that as treatment. Convalescent sera is also has been often used as a like first line therapy. It was used in Ebola, and it was not very effective, and it's being used in the U.S. At least convalescent sera has been used for, I think, 80,000 patients. And unfortunately, it was used as a compassionate use. That was the regulatory framework that was used. It wasn't used in randomized clinical trials. And because that was the decision early on, we don't have the data that we need to be able to say, like, okay, it works in these types of people, but not in those. It works for people who are early infection or late. It probably has some effect. It probably works better for people who are earlier in infection, but unfortunately, it's often used for people who are very severely ill, and it might be not enough to help those people. So it's basically a mess, and I really, and when the president made it an emergency use authorization for it, it just makes it even harder to do randomized clinical trials, because people are not gonna wanna say, oh, well, individuals want everything, all the therapy options. And they're not gonna wanna participate in a trial where they might not get it. And so that's why we end up in the situation where we have 80,000 people who have gotten this therapy and no idea really if it works. It's, you know, that's why you need to have these systems in place in the beginning and do these clinical trials. Because a lot of times people say, well, like, you don't want to harm, you want to throw everything at these poor patients. But if you don't set it up to learn something, then you're going to end up months down the road without any data, and you might be harming patients. So, because it's not risk-free. Right. Some people have a bad reaction to the convalescent sera, and people will die. So it's really a mess.
Okay, one other question here, and you had also mentioned earlier about the immunity certificates, and we had heard things about it here. How might that be helpful or harmful? I guess if it's used right, it can be helpful, but if it's not, I mean, so that, you know, what is the latest on this immunity certificate?
Yeah, so people want to have it, like if you've had it, you're presumed immune. And we see some reinfections. For the most part, we're not seeing a lot of them. So there is probably something, even if we don't know what it is, whether it's T cells or antibodies or something that that leaves people immune to reinfection. We don't know how long that's going to last. And that's a big problem for coming up with all the systems to put into place to develop a certificate. Like how long is the certificate good for? So there are a lot of other problems with it too, that you know, the whole false positive, false negative, then you know, you're making big choices or big decisions about people that they can't, that might not be accurate. And then a big concern is if you try and make it so like you can't go to work unless you have a positive this immunity certificate, people will go out of their way to get it. They'll go out of their way to get sick so that they can get that certificate. And that's contrary to public health.
Right.
So what's the latest on immunity certificates? I think what we're gonna see is once there are vaccines available, then people will use that the way that you use your, I don't know if you have seen or have a WHO yellow book that has all your vaccines in it. To be able to travel to West Africa, I had to get a yellow fever vaccine, and it's in my yellow book that's stamped to my passport. Border control, can look at it and make sure that I'm protected. So that's a little bit more of a traditional immune certificate that we'll probably see when there's vaccine. There are people who are developing apps to show when you've been tested. So that's another kind of certificate. So if I test negative, I'm not currently infected, I might have a certificate on my phone that I could show when the last date is that I got tested, that so I could travel, go on a plane. So that might be another way that immune certificates might be used. But past infection, it's not looking like that is going to work out.
Right. The apps thing, I know it's being used in China, because if you certain buildings, you show your phone with your QR code. And so I know in China, because they're ahead of the curve, they happen. So we here in Hong Kong, there's been talk of us also using that certain type of technology in the near future. But we still haven't heard anything. And I think a lot of people are really interested in travel. There's been talk of travel bubbles and getting on a plane. Like I said, that the story of coming back from the States with my friends, trying to get that test was a nightmare. And maybe over time, I think more labs are going to be working on it. So maybe it's going to not take that much trouble. But one of the questions I was curious, we talked about, is that in last month, and here in Hong Kong, we were one of the first to talk about reinfection. There was Hong Kong, you put out the study that there was a 30-some-year-old traveler reinfected. And then there's been subsequent cases in Europe and other parts of the world that had reinfection. So do you know anything more about that? Is that something that we need to worry about? I mean, right. Going back to the immunity certificate question, I mean, it seems like all of a sudden we're hearing that there are trends, some reinfection.
Yeah. So, I mean, we'll unfortunately, this is the kind of thing that you just need to wait and see and do careful science about. There are reports of reinfection. There were anecdotal reports for a while, but what they did is you have to do very careful studies to sequence the virus that somebody is infected with, then follow them over time. And then if they get sick again, sequence that virus that they're infected with again to see if it's even SARS-CoV-2 or if it's something else. You know, so you have to, it takes some planning and some follow-up to be able to do these studies to make sure that like the SARS-CoV-2 that you were infected with 2 months ago has slight differences that you would expect from the SARS-CoV-2 that you were infected with, in the present time. So is it going to be a problem? It's not surprising that we are seeing it. Because everybody's immune system is a little bit different, and people have different experiences that shape how they get how they respond to infection. Whether it's going to be for something that everyone has had is going to need to worry about. Only time will tell. There are some viruses that we don't build up strong immune responses to, and so you get reinfections. Other viruses, you can have pretty much lifelong immunity or at least decades of immunity. Hopefully the vaccine will take that place and keep people's immunity up. Even with the vaccine, we're not sure if you're going to need to have boosters for that and how often. So there's a lot that needs to be learned, a lot of careful science that needs to happen.
And you also, in your presentation, your recommendation about the flu test, flu shots. And I also read something today that they recommend sooner rather than later in the September, October to get your flu shots. And then I think one of our previous discussion with Dr. Kong and others, it's flu shots every year we have to take them. So right. Do you think right now with COVID, that is also likely that every year we may have to do it, you know, because of the way that it just kind of is changing itself.
It's a pretty stable virus for what it, it doesn't mutate quite as much as flu. Part of that is because it has an editor within the virus that checks, that's a proofreader for, so it's not the most stable virus, but it's a lot more stable than flu. Flu, one of the problems with flu is that there are different strains that come from birds and different environments. So you get vaccinated for several different flu strains every year, and whatever is the most common ones that year, the WHO makes a recommendation that that's the one that we're going to make vaccine for. It would be, there are efforts to make a universal flu vaccine, so that wouldn't be necessary, but it's harder, you know, it's harder than it may appear, and so we're not there yet. And frankly, since there already is this mechanism to have the flu vaccine every year, it hasn't been a priority for investment, I think. And so, yeah. So every virus is different. So it makes it interesting, but also kind of difficult to plan.
Okay. This question from the audience asked, why do PCR tests take more days than the antigen tests? Is there any other reason than the need for the labs with trained techs to process them?
Mm-hmm. So the test itself only takes somewhere between 2 and 4 hours. So, but it needs to be, the test itself needs, you need to have a PCR machine, which is used in a laboratory. That has to have a certain amount of safety. You have to have a trained technician. So it's all infrastructure, really, because theoretically you could have PCR distributed and you could get a result in 4 or 6 hours or something like that if you had enough of it and enough infrastructure to support it. So yeah, it's all the other stuff. There were some shortages of some of the reagents, some of the materials that you need to do PCR. So that has slowed times a little bit, but I don't think that is as much of a problem, at least in the US right now. It's really just labor and infrastructure.
I see. I think we only have a few minutes to go, but one of the last question for you, that for me has been like, today I was just reading some numbers, some articles about studies by Chinese and American scientists looking at the statistics, the numbers of COVID-19 from beginning. And they're kind of projecting forward, saying that this particular virus, this pandemic, the death rate could be about the same as the flu of 1916, or Spanish flu of 1916. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's accurate? I mean, are we too soon to look at this? Because, and also from your perspective, what are we learning from mm-hmm. this particular, with COVID, that's comparable or different from the flu of 1916?
So as it happens, I teach a class on the it was 1918, the flu of that year. There are a lot of parallels, but I think that even though the death numbers may eclipse 1918, the percentage of the world that is affected will probably still be much smaller. 1918, what characterized that virus was that it had a high mortality rate for people who were at the prime of their life, their 20s and 30s, but it's not, even though that's what people focus on, it's not like it was a great idea for people who are elderly or children. A lot of people died, and so I think one of the big things one of the only positives about COVID is that we don't see the huge numbers of children dying that you do with any flu. And so I think that is, even though I'm not saying it's risk-free, there were a lot of things that were terrible about 1918. But what was different also about it is that people didn't know what was happening. We didn't know what the flu was at that time. There were no vaccines for flu. There was a lot of people who had even no idea that the contagion was coming their way because of all of the strict suppression of the news media because of it was World War I. So it's things are bad now, but I think things were worse in 1918.
And right now you talk about media and is the media helping in this? I mean, because now we have to deal with social media. And one of the reasons we started this program in February was because we had so many, you know, in February, we didn't know anything. And also this science, I feel it's very important to listen to those in the know. You have an illustrious career. You have got your PhD in Hopkins. So why is there this such kind of, especially in the United States, of this knee-jerk, you know, against science? I mean, facts and the role media is playing in this particular COVID versus, right. It's very interesting you said in 1918 that the and it's called Spanish flu because they have the freedom, freedom of press over there. So kind of contrast that, and how can, and this is another reason it's great to have, and we will have all of those resources on our website to share. It's a double-edged sword, I guess, but how do you think community, how can we do better in this area?
Yeah, I mean, it's a real problem, and it's a whole nother, probably another talk, but it's the role that media can play. I mean, it certainly can, the information that can be imparted, responsible media lets people learn so much and what to do to protect themselves. But yes, there's a lot of discontent. People don't like being told what to do, and without the calm leadership that trusts in science, it gets devolved into it gets politicized, and it's terrible here in the U.S. that wearing a mask is seen as a political statement, it's. I don't know what to say except that it's terrible, and that's one of the reasons why I'm pretty concerned about what's going to happen with the vaccines. We didn't get into this, but right yesterday there was a news report that states were told to start preparing for receiving vaccine and how to distribute vaccine by November 1st. November 1st is an interesting date because November 3rd is when we go to the polls or vote by mail to elect the next president. So are we going to have a rushed vaccine in this with this level of lack of trust in science? There are a lot of people who are going to be worried that they're not getting the right information about the vaccine and may or may not take it. So it's a mess. And I think, yeah, you should have another talk about community trust and what public health can do to counter this. But it doesn't come without money. You know, people do what they can to go against the anti-vaccine people and the people who spread misinformation. But if you don't make it a priority to fight that online and give people the resources to do so, it's just, they get drowned out because the anti-vaxxers have a lot more money than the public health.
Wow, that's really ironic. I didn't realize, I mean, the vaccine is a very interesting story. And we're also here anticipating to hear more about it. I know China and this region, there is also, right, a rush to do that, and here in Hong Kong as well. I know there's some cooperation. So we're really, yeah, there's a lot more, and that's why we're going to continue our COVID-19 updates until this is over, and it will be over.
It will be over,
and hopefully we will learn from this and collectively as a local community, but also as a global community. I think. There are, and what you just talk about the survey, I mean, you know, if we can only share that information, more effectively we can all learn from each other. And that's really, really important. So I want to thank you so much for taking time from your schedule to be with us. And stay safe. And I want to thank our audience for joining us tonight. We are in the midst of confirming episode 23 with professionals from Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. And so stay tuned on our website. And in the meantime, everybody stay safe, stay healthy, and stay vigilant. So good night, and thank you. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you. Goodall.